Welcome to the new talk, the new European surveillance landscape. Of those of you who are not at the lake and not, so those of you who are still here, not at the lake, they are really serious about this topic. And this talk is about the investigation agencies in the EU coming up with new political measures or new laws that increase surveillance and decrease our rights as citizens. And our speaker, Matthias Monroy, who is an activist and journalist, will talk about this very topic. So a round of applause, please. Thank you very much. I want you to give an overview of what we can expect the next coming years, because after the election of the European Parliament, there are new plans, but also plans that continue working on some old plans. And I want to show you the most important aspects, and I will talk about decrees and guidelines that matter here. An important topic is the decree of the prevention of distribution of terrorist internet content, and you guys probably know it under the name upload filter, which tries to prevent bad content. A proposal exists, and the European Commission usually has the task to make a proposal, and then the Parliament and the Council of the European Union negotiate the laws. And when the European Parliament creates certain the committee has so far not processed the upload filter plans, but the council still has to acknowledge and accept it, and this whole procedure takes several years until the final laws will have been created. So what's really interesting is that the Parliament has said that in principle they agree with the decree, especially the removal of internet contents, but they still negotiate if this should be across borders, if the removal, the instruction of removal should function across borders. If the LKA in Germany wants something to be removed, then this would only function in Germany. And now this is an ongoing negotiation, and most likely it will be loosened in the future, because there are already people working on this on the political level. For instance, the Europol police unit already runs a reporting office for illegal internet contents. So, and then this police agency passes on these reportings to the internet providers. But these are still only referrals, so they are not legally binding, and the providers do not have to follow the orders of Interpol. But still, the amount of, or the fraction of deletions is still very high, so it's about 85%. And
de facto bereitet man eigentlich alles vor.
And we can see that that basically only the laws are so even though everything works already in practice, there still have to be laws in place that make everything official.
Aber jetzt schon werden Webseiten,
even now there are websites being targeted,
so heißt das auf der Ebene, beschäftigen.
which are illegal, and of course they also want to extend the whole framework on cyber crimes. So still, this is all voluntarily, but it's still like being made official. After the Christchurch attack, there were
von Regierungen aufgeschrieben. Die Präsentation wird auch online sein. Die Sachen sind verlinkt. Das könnt ihr euch dann, wenn ihr möchtet, nochmal in Ruhe angucken.
So I've also collected these things here, and I've also put the links in here. I think the most important thing right now is this Christchurch call tomorrow at the G7. I'm pretty sure they're definitely going to remind people about the Christchurch call again, and will tell you, well, after Christchurch, it is especially important that there's some kind of routine based on which states essentially remove certain particular types of content from the internet.
Was da auch noch sehr wichtig ist,
another thing that's going to be really important here, what's been prepared in the background is something in the EU, which is the so-called EU Internet Forum. It was initially a voluntary event where the big internet companies such as Facebook, Google participated voluntarily. So they met voluntarily with the EU Commission to kind of discuss the system about voluntary content removal and how to improve the system. But the EU used this forum to put pressure onto these companies and to essentially force them more and more to essentially implement these what are essentially simply requests for takedowns rather than actual force, binding forces to take them down. So there have already been two trips to California. So usually they meet at Facebook or Google, and they think about, so that's also something that happened after Christchurch, and so they discuss together how you can take care of a case like this where you need to do something very quickly, right? So the question is, how can you do this as quickly as possible, which is not necessarily a legal way, right? So the question is, how do you remove content as quickly as possible? So I've described all of this in a more roundabout way this time, because I want you to know that this initiative, in terms of the legislative initiative, is very much still at the very beginning. But de facto, these states have already kind of like pushed this very far. So I think the question is, how much the EU Parliament and also national parliaments still have to say as part of this process. Next topic electronic evidence.
Da geht es darum, grenzüberschreitend.
This is about data that cross borders or are on servers cross nationally, so for example like the cloud, and how that data can be confiscated.
Also im Moment ist das ja auch schon möglich.
So that's also already possible now. So for example, if someone is being investigated by the police, you can request a provider to provide the information that they have about this individual. That's something that happens based on international law right now, and that's something that can take a while. And so police and other investigative agencies essentially want to speed up this process to and want to be able to directly request this information from providers. So there's also a suggested decree. One thing that I need to say here, so the difference between a decree and a guideline is that a decree is something that is much more comprehensive. So it has to essentially be implemented from A to Z very specifically, but if it's just a guideline, the member states of the EU can come up with their own laws and essentially have these own laws in different ways that vary from on the national level. And they can also adjust them nationally and, for example, kind of weaken them on the national level as well. But in this case, they specifically went for the format of a decree, because it's a pretty far-reaching demand. Way less has happened here than with regards to the upload filters. So there is no official point of view of the EU Parliament yet. That is something that's supposed to be published in the fall. So one question is, what does the EU want with a decree like this, especially if most of the important providers are not even in the EU? So that's why there are now negotiations with the United States, who have a similar system called the Cloud Act,
diese EU-Evidenzverordnung,
to basically make the Cloud Act and this EU decree compatible and to allow mutual requests for information between these two legal systems. What's important here is that the European Council can essentially have these negotiations happen without the EU Parliament being involved. So they essentially have no way, they have no say in this. So these negotiations have actually already happened. So the Trump administration says, well, generally we're open to something like this and for these mutual requests. So you can ask for information in the US. And so the FBI can also directly send in requests for information in Europe. And the US government essentially wants to expand this to telecommunications. So it's unclear what exactly they're talking about in that case. That's something that's being negotiated right now. But basically what they're asking for is that they want to be able to listen in on telephone phone conversations in Europe. So it's not just supposed to be about internet, but also about telephone data. And so we need to kind of keep an eye on this to see where that goes. Another similar story is also happening on the level of the European, not the European Council, but the, so it's a European, it's not an EU institution, but it's something that also includes, for example, Turkey and the US.
Und das soll jetzt noch erweitert werden.
And they already have some kind of agreements, and that's something that's supposed to be expanded to this, to access to data, internet data as well.
And so, yeah,
I think these are the two extremely important things. One is the upload filter, and one is the other thing on electronic evidence.
Das heißt Interoperabilität.
So now we're talking another big topic, which is interoperability. So Mr. de Maizière, the previous Minister of the Interior in Germany, talked about this. So there are several decrees that are being changed right now. So this is about two police databases, and I'm going to present the six most important to you. So I'm just going to kill you all with this very, very easy to understand graphic first. I also have a link for this, but if you want to understand this, you cannot avoid this. This is something that the European Commission has published 2 years ago. That's all databases that the EU is essentially running and that the EU is planning to run in the future. So this gray area is something that we're not interested in. That's basically all the national systems. But we're interested in everything that's in this blue circle, in this blue bubble. And these databases, I want to talk about six of those. And they're supposed to be essentially fused. And these are databases that include biometric information such as fingerprints and pictures of your face. So that's six different databases that were created for six different purposes.
Diese Daten in einem Silo zusammengefasst.
And this data is supposed to be concentrated and essentially centralized in one single database where they can be searched. So I'm just going to present these one by one. This is all six of them.
Was außerdem passieren soll,
another thing that's supposed to happen is that once this central database exists, where you have everyone's the picture of everyone's face and everyone's fingerprint, so also that includes third states, so not just people who are asylum seekers or asking for visa, but for example, someone who enters the EU for tourism purposes or for business purposes, those people all have to provide their biometric data, and all of that would be in this database. And so in the background, these are going to be compared, whether there's something that's kind of like looks suspicious. For example, if someone has a fingerprint that is linked to two different identities. It's supposed to be easier to search these things, so there's supposed to be one interface that essentially accesses all six databases at the same time, so you don't have to look at them separately, to essentially lower latency and require less time for these searches. And so this decree already exists, so this decision exists, and now the question is how to implement this technologically. And the European Commission is going to publish further decisions on the technical implementation, but basically this is already being prepared right now. And so I just want to present these six databases that are going to be centralized here. The most important one is the Schengen Information System. That is the big European Union police database that currently includes 85 million bits of data, but that's kind of like really bits of data. So it's something about like maybe stolen, for example, like stolen vehicles, stolen cars, and there's maybe 1 million people that are also included in this database. And for many of these, they actually have pictures of their faces and they have fingerprint data. And so this one also will have certain kinds of innovations, and there's going to be updates. So once all of these will be centralized, then of course the decree has to be changed for each database as well.
Das geht auch mit einer Aufrüstung einher. Also
and that's also something that's going to make these databases that's going to make these databases stronger. So for example, one thing is that they're going to create like a new fingerprinting system. So for example, it's something that's supposed to be once you're somewhere where a crime was committed, so you should be able to essentially search the entire database right away from on the ground. Another big important database is the Visa information system, where everyone who essentially applies for a visa in the EU has to provide their fingerprint and a picture of their face. This decree is also something that hasn't been passed yet, and so these changes have not been passed yet. And so potential changes here are related to whether children also have to provide fingerprints. Right now, it's mandatory from the age of 14 years old onwards, and the European Council essentially wants to lower this minimum, this age, to 6, so that children from the age of 6 onwards would have to be provide fingerprints. Another important database is the fingerprint database for asylum seekers. That is pretty big, and I think that's some where you can also tell how this works on the European, on the EU level, which was initially created to be able to identify people who requested asylum in different places, maybe under different names. And then they realized, oh my God, it's so useful if we have hundreds of thousands of fingerprints in this database and the police can use this. And so they can use it to look for criminals. And so in hindsight, they essentially changed the decree and expanded the purpose of this database. So wow, all of a sudden, police can also just access this data of asylum seekers. And so this database is also the first one that's going to be expanded to faces and pictures of faces as well. So you will be able to search for faces as well in this database.
Und dann gibt es noch,
and then there's a database that lots of people don't know, which is a database of people who have already been sentenced. It's also an EU-wide database where everyone who's been sentenced to anything by a court, which under which condition you also need to provide biometric data, so those people are essentially included in this ECRIS database, the European Criminal Records Information System. Then there are two more databases that have been decided upon but that don't exist yet. The first one is an entry and exit system. So there's a decision that this entry exit system EES should create. So regardless for what purpose you enter the country, you essentially end up in this system. So if you're from a country that is not an EU member, or so if you don't have a passport from an EU member, you have to leave your biometric data. You have to provide your biometric data, and it's going to be saved in this database. And this is something that's supposed to be implemented in 2020, 2021. And so there's several security research projects that are looking into this right now. And that's extremely interesting because people are saying, well, if people have to provide their biometric data and that's not contained in the passport, so we're taking biometric data from these people that essentially slows down border controls by maybe 2 minutes. And that also means border controls are going to take more time. And so they're trying to optimize this by using security applications that essentially automate this, so that people can, for example, provide their fingerprints without touch or like at some kind of kiosk. So some airports already, I mean, have these like self-service kiosks, and so in the future you might be able to use these to essentially save your fingerprints and your face, and then get kind of a token, and you go to the border, and so they only have to put that data into the database. So there's several research projects into this right now, and then there's another system for registering your travel. So if you've ever been to the U.S., you've probably heard of ESTA. Before you go, you only need to tell them, well, I'm coming on this and this day, I'm going for this in particular purpose, maybe as a tourist, I'm going to stay for such a time frame, and I'll probably be staying here. So you need to provide that information before you travel. And so this picture is from an EU security research project, and this is the avatar that they're using as a lie detector. So basically, you have to talk to this avatar that will ask you 15 questions. So these are pretty simple, something that someone at the border would also ask you.
Dieser Avatar hat aber die
and but this avatar has the ability to essentially detect
mit ihrer Webcam, also
so you basically have to respond through a webcam. So this is something that you'd be doing from home. I mean, most of you probably not, because you probably have a EU passport, but someone who's coming from outside of the EU. And so that person, and so this avatar is essentially supposed to recognize whether someone is nervous when responding to certain questions, and that would then mean that once that person actually comes to the border, would actually be questioned more deeply. So there's also lots of security research going on in the background right now for these new information systems and to optimize these new information systems. And obviously that's also big business for all these companies that essentially provide biometric data applications.
And now a different topic that I also consider important and what is not getting enough attention. You might know the term follow the money, to use financial data to pursue suspicions, and this is of great value because then we know who has sent money to which other person and who has which bank accounts, for example, and it's like a data retention or some form of data retention. And according to the money laundering decree, there is a new plan that the national registers are being combined. And I wanted to mention this. And when I say data retention, then I say this just shortly, because you guys know a lot about it already. So, I mean, the data retention is somewhat cancelled, but then again, there are new plans to introduce something very similar that despite the EU court saying that this is not possible, that there still politicians plan to have something like a restricted data restriction, even though it is actually not restricted. And they try to say it's just a regional data retention. For example, we define that countries in which there was a terrorist attack, they have regions of elevated risk. So for instance, Belgium and France are therefore allowed to introduce data retention for 6 months. So these are the ideas that politicians are throwing around, and while in practice, I don't expect that it will be a restricted data retention, it will be a full data retention. And the people who work on this from our side are people from from Digital Courage, who try to work against these plans. And there's also another system that manages DNA traces. And with this system, it's possible to look up DNA traces for all of the EU's countries. And now this system will be extended for facial recognition. And because politicians say, hey, it would be good to have this. And, well, it still applies what I said before. It's being prepared, but there are no laws yet. And it will likely come, and we will have face recognition at the borders. And of course, it's not like high tech. It's something that police agencies already do, but they only have access to national databases. And right now they only contain records of people who have been under criminal investigation. And now the plans are to extend this to the whole European Union. And there is another project that is very much under the radar, even though I think it's very important. It's being tried that on a technical level to develop software that makes it easier to request information, and it was developed by the German Federal Police. And they want to have it make it easier to retrieve data,
and
so that all the police records are being connected and made available. across borders. And if you follow the politics or activism, then you see how loose the police is sometimes with their own guidelines. And there are, even if the person is actually not sentenced to anything, there is still all of this data about the people who were investigated, and they are kept somewhat indefinitely. And if a person has been under investigation in the past, then of course these records are still available for new research, new investigations. I wanted to mention this, and also people who disrupt public peace are also being recorded, or basically the German federal police wants to keep the disrupting people as a, they want to keep track of these people, and they want to share this across borders. And with this ADAP system, this will be a lot easier, and it's political.
And
then there's the EU passenger system, so that the airlines are required to send data about who has booked which flights, and there are plans to extend this to trains and ships as well, but this is still very much under dispute. Because then you have to control the access to the trains, and this is an infrastructure that currently doesn't exist. And there are some countries that say, yeah, sure, we can arrange that. And there are other countries like Germany that say, no, this would be very problematic for our high-speed rail network. And so, for instance, the German trains system strain agencies against this. Two more slides on Europol, which will be extended. So Europol is getting new competences all the time. One of them is decryption. So there is a plan to create a decryption unit of Europol. And what should be highlighted is that Europol is not responsible for decrypting themselves, but for transferring knowledge and competence to national police agencies so that they are able to decrypt encrypted data. And Europol will basically facilitate decryption and make it also more cheaper for police agencies to decrypt without being reliant on commercial companies.
Außerdem auch Telekommunikation.
Europol should also help. They should also have to decrypt telecommunication data, including end-to-end encryption. And most likely, this will mean that they will deploy Trojan horses. And the establishment of this competence centrum in Europol is well underway at this moment.
Und schließlich,
and finally,
macht Europol
there is something else about Europol. There is an agreement with other countries outside of the European Union. So there are some strategic agreements, which is by itself not something new. So for instance, in the fight against drugs, they cooperate a lot.
Ich habe die Staaten aufgezählt, also da sind ein paar dabei.
So I've enumerated the countries that with which they want to exchange data about individuals.
Strittig ist auch das Abkommen.
And under dispute is that is the agreement between Israel and and the EU because.
And so the EU doesn't recognize the, Israel's occupation of particular areas, but after 1967, I think, but basically that there are police stations in that area. So essentially by working with police that works in these occupied territories, that could be considered an independent, like kind of like an informal recognition of these occupations. But the Commission is already has a mandate to negotiate there, and so the European Commission is already negotiating with these states. That's it?
Zu dem Bild will ich noch kurz was sagen.
So just want to say something about this picture. I put a few pictures in here, and this one, the first one in particular, is from one of the security research programs, which I love to read because it's one way of figuring out where we are going, but they're also full of kind of like showing off, right? So they just like assume that everything is going to work out and going to be possible. So this particular picture is part of the program Red Alert, where they're essentially, which is essentially supposed to look at the dark web and uncover the identities of people who are using it and identify these people. So yeah, that's that. Thank you. Please, one round of applause, please.
Ja, vielen herzlichen Dank.
Well, yeah, thank you so much, Matthias. So we have roughly 10 minutes for questions for Q&A. So this is your opportunity to ask follow-up questions to Matthias. We have two living microphone stands in here. So if you have a question, please walk up to one of these people and ask your question via the microphone. As far as I can tell, the internet seems to be at the lake as well, so they don't have any questions, but you can ask questions. Ask yourself, what do you want to know from Matthias? Ah, there's someone. First question.
Yeah, ich glaube, es ist offen.
Yeah, I think it's open. Okay. So I have a question about the database that collects information from people, or is supposed to collect information from people who use trains in Germany. Because you usually buy tickets online, and so that already ends up in a database. And that I've also heard that they are considering whether they might just get rid of the regular ticket machines where you can just use cash to buy tickets. So wouldn't that itself lead to essentially make surveillance much easier even without having a check-in at the airport?
Yeah, also
or airport-style check-in. Well, I'm actually skeptical whether Germany is going to participate in something like this or going to come around to participating in something like this, and if they do with many, many restrictions, because right now it's also possible in Germany to book a train ticket very spontaneously. So you just go to the train station, get a ticket at the at the ticket machine for a train that leaves in 10 minutes, and a system like that would be much more difficult under these circumstances. So I'm extremely skeptical. There's lots of disagreement amongst the states as well. And I have no idea whether this is actually going to happen. If yes, I think the entire German train system would have to be changed and turned on its head completely. And I'd rather imagine that maybe some individual states might say that they will do it. So the Netherlands, Belgium, France, and the UK are negotiating this right now. So these are the countries who already have these trains where you need to register beforehand, where it's also something that is checked in some of these cases. So I think what's going to happen is that these countries are essentially going to cooperate, and so there's going to be no EU expansion on this. So there's not going to be an EU train passenger system, but a multilateral system that several countries can just participate in based on an ad hoc basis. Thank you so much. And so the second mic in the back, please. Hello, I have a question about one of these graphics that you were showing us kind of in the beginning. I think the picture showed requests for deletion.
Im ersten Teil hauptsächlich.
In the first part primarily contained archive.org. And then towards the end there were other websites, but there were no absolute numbers. So I just wanted to check whether you had any more details on that or were able to provide any additional details and where you got that. Oh yeah, so this picture, this graphic is something that is, I think, so I didn't even mention this because there is already a deletion database.
Große Anbieter zusammengeschlossen
where several big websites came together and once content has been deleted, they essentially put deleted content into a hash file. So once re-uploaded, they don't even get uploaded into the internet, but can be deleted right away. So that's what we call upload filters. So this is something that's happening on a voluntary basis, and several companies essentially came together. In the beginning, it was like all the big ones. I don't quite remember. I think it was Google, Facebook, Microsoft. They're definitely part of these every single time. And then later on, there were smaller ones that joined them as well. So, for example, several smaller ones joined as well later. And this cooperation, this hash database, it's being run by the Global Counterterrorism Initiative. So I think, I'm also linking to those on this particular slide. And they're the ones who published this graphic because they essentially looked at which websites are affected by deletion requests or primarily affected by deletion requests. So I'll put that up on the Fahrplan website. So one more question from the front. Hello, thank you for the presentation. My name is Peter. I have two questions. Should I just ask two of them at the same time? Yeah, okay. The first one, you presented this database in the beginning, which was an entry-exit data bank. One was a migrant database about people who come from countries that are not part of the EU. Are there any plans to also connect these databases to biometric databases that are being created right now as part of, for example, creating and giving out new IDs in Germany? So are these national databases going to be connected with those? So that's the first question. The second question is much more direct. So these decrees and these decisions that you mentioned are in some cases part of the political, still in the middle of the political decision-making process. So in some cases, some nation states can still get involved with that. And so maybe we can talk about that afterwards, but
yeah.
Yeah, of course. As usual, I will be available for questions after this talk. You might also notice that I feel a sense of urgency with this, because for me it's also important that there is movement against these things and there is pressure against these things, because I'm also very interested in how can you kind of get people who are involved in internet policy interested in these topics. And the other question, so the first question, whether biometric data from national databases, for example from German citizens that are already in the German registration system, whether that data is going to end up in that database. So for now, there is no intention of doing that. So this essentially only includes databases that have data of people who are either had to be registered somewhere for some reason or who essentially ended up in a criminal database system. So for example, if you end up in the Schengen information system,
übrigens nicht nur sogenannte Kriminelle landen darin.
That's not only criminals, but that also includes people, for example, who have to be deported or who are told that they have to be deported from the EU. So that's actually the largest part and the majority of people in that database. So it's not actually a database of criminals, but it's primarily a database of foreigners. So anyone who essentially kind of had to provide their fingerprints to the state at some point, so all of these people are being put together as part of the interoperability decree. And then that add on to that the data of people from non-member states that have to cross one of the EU borders. But so again, this is also something where the decree is already signed, essentially. So if you're a as national of an EU member state, you have been, you will get checked more thoroughly. You may have noticed that in the recent past. So they check a larger number of databases, but nothing is being saved in a database anywhere. So for example, if you were in Turkey, or you come back from Latin America by plane from your holiday, and then once you cross the outer EU border, no information about that is being saved anywhere. If you are from a different country, so if you're not an EU national, that information is being saved in a database. So after the attacks in 2015, France demanded the system that was kind of in the middle of being built, and is now technologically still in the middle of being created. So France demanded this to be expanded to EU citizens. So that's something that didn't happen back then. But as usual, often you only need a single reason to say, oh, well, now we have this great system, and so we already have the fingerprinting system. It's really easy, and nobody notices this. So it might be useful in the future to kind of have a protocol of who crosses borders where and when. So usually these systems are expanded afterwards. Great. So there's another question in the back.
Hello.
Hi, I'm Chris. I'm Switzerland. And what is
Aufgabe dieser Superdatenbank übernehmen?
What? So there are rumors that Switzerland will actually take care of the database. Is that rumor true?
Und was ist da dran?
So,
because
observed from the outside, it would make sense. Because then no one is really like doing the dirty work. So yes, Switzerland is actually part of some information systems like the Schengen information system, and therefore they are also involved in the interoperability of the databases, because the Schengen information system is, because it's used and queried as part of border crossings. If Switzerland will participate in the whole system, I don't know, but I don't think so, because there are some databases involved that Switzerland does not use. Of course, the system could be configured in such a way that Switzerland only had access to the databases that are shared anyway, but ultimately, yeah. So thank you very much. If no one else wants to know something, neither physically nor from the internet, then I like to have a warm round of applause for our speaker. Thank you very much for all technicians and the translation angels. If you want to spend another applause, please.